you're appearing for who?
I will appear for the appellant.
Yes, you don't just say be in summary procedure.
We are appearing for the appellant, who is present in court.
Yes.
For the respondent, Mr. Timothy Amerit, State Attorney. And Mr. Ivan Chasid, State Attorney. Appear.
Appear for who?
For the respondent, Amerit. And for the
The file which was called was 79.
I should like. The matter is coming for judgment. And we already received the same.
Dated 1st August 2019, wherein the appellant was found guilty of the offense of cyber harassment, that's the on the first count, contrary to section 24.1.2a of the Computer Misuse Act, which, but acquitted her on the offense of offensive communication, contrary to section 25 of the said act on count two. In finding the case against the appellant on count one of the offense of cyber harassment, contrary to section 24, subsection 1, paragraph 2a of the Computer Misuse Act, the lower court held that the statement made in the post found on Facebook account in the names of appellant were obscene, lewd, and indecent based on the Eklund test for obscenity, as established by the English case of Regina versus Eklund, reported in 1868, an English law report, Queen's Bench report at page 360, in which the issue before that court was a statutory interpretation of the word obscene, which was found in the English Obscene Publication Act of 1857, which authorized the destruction of obscene books. The lower court adopted this, the holding in that case in whole, holding in the holding in Eklund case cited above, where in it concluded, and I quote, there is a host of decisions which I am citing here under, where courts have pronounced themselves on the issue of what is obscene or indecent. The Eklund test is the legal test for obscenity. The lower trial court then went on to set a host of other cases like Shreya Shingal versus Union of India, with petition criminal number 167 of 2012, and being convinced that the Eklund test above was applicable to the case before it against the appellant, since the posting found in Facebook page titled Stella Nyanzi tended to deprave and corrupt those whose minds are open to such immoral influences, educational or scientific value, and thus was a danger to the moral fiber of the youth and children, and even to the general public. Based on the above conclusions, the lower court proceeded to convict appellant accordingly on these two counts, as I've already mentioned, and sentenced her to 18 months in custody. Arising from the conviction and sentence by the lower trial court, the appellant was dissatisfied and aggrieved by the judgment and orders of the lower court, and appealed to this court, which is the first appellate court, on 10 grounds of appeal as follows. A, that the learned trial magistrate erred in law and fact when she entertained the case against the appellant, yet the court had no jurisdiction. B, that the learned trial court erred in law and fact. I put them in those numericals. I mean, these are those letters, not numbering them, but they're still the 10. So the A is one, actually. That the learned, I can start from the A, which is one, that the learned trial magistrate erred in law and fact when she entertained the case against the appellant, yet the court had no jurisdiction. B, which is two, that the learned trial magistrate erred in law and fact when she allowed the prosecution of the appellant on a charge that was incurably defective, unacceptably vague, barred in law, and barred by law. C, that the learned trial magistrate erred in law and fact when she failed to accord the appellant the necessary facilities to compel the attendance of defense witnesses and thereby infringe on the appellant's right to a fair hearing. D, which is four, that the learned trial magistrate erred in law and fact when she failed or refused to facilitate the compulsory attendance and examination of witness DW1 called Mustafa B. Mugisha after he had absconded from court and therefore infringed on the appellant's rights to a fair hearing. E, which is five, that the learned trial magistrate erred in law and fact when she prematurely closed the defense case. F, which is six, that the learned trial magistrate committed a grave procedural irregularity when she deprived the appellant of the right to address the court after the close of the defense case and replied or opposition to the written submissions of the prosecution, which were concealed from the appellant. G, which is seven, that the learned trial magistrate erred in law and fact when she failed to properly evaluate the evidence on record and thus arrive at a wrong decision in convicting the appellant of cyber harassment. H, which is eight, that the learned trial magistrate contravened Article 28.5 of the 1995 Constitution of Uganda, section, as amended, section 123 of the Magistrates Court Act, and the Judicature Video Audio Link Rules 2016, when she purported to conduct proceedings on 2 August 2019 via Visual Audio Link. I, which is nine, that the learned trial magistrate passed an illegal and disproportionate sentence. J, that the learned trial magistrate was biased against the appellant throughout the trial and thus failed to accord the appellant a fair hearing. Arising from above 10 grounds of appeal, the appellant prayed to this honorable court, which is the first appellate court, to quash the conviction against her and set over the sentence against her. Both sides filed lengthy written submissions in addition to presenting in court also very lengthy oral submissions. In a trial of a criminal nature, now I go to the legal principles. Trials of a criminal nature are governed by established legal principles. It is therefore imperative that their mention be made at the onset here, but for the guide criminal justice practice of courts of law. These legal principles are A, burden and standard of proof. In all criminal matters, consideration must be had on the burden of proof of a criminal and the standard of proof. In regards to the burden of proof, this lies with the prosecution, while the standard of proof for one to be found guilty of an offense is that which is beyond reasonable doubt. The principle of burden of proof is higher than that in civil matter and is grounded in under Article 28.3 of the Constitution of the Republic of Uganda, which provides that, and I quote, every person who is charged with a criminal offense shall be presumed innocent until proved guilty or until that person has pleaded guilty, close quotation. This principle was first articulated in the landmark case of Wilmington versus DPP 1935, appeal cases, English appeal cases at page 462 in the House of Lords of the United Kingdom, where the presumption of innocence was first articulated in the Commonwealth, and Uganda follows the Commonwealth jurisdiction, common law jurisdiction. In law, the case is remembered for introducing the metaphorical golden thread running through the law relating to the presumption of innocence, with emphasis being that an accused person can only be convicted by a court of law on the strength of the case as proved by the prosecution and not on the weakness of the defense given by an accused. In Wilmington's case cited above, briefly, Mr. Reginald Wilmington sought her out and, using a gun, shot her dead. Reginald Wilmington was convicted of murder. He appealed the case, which reached the House of Lords, now the Supreme Court of England. The House of Lords quashed the conviction on appeal, with Viscount Sankey J stating that, and I quote, and this is very important, throughout the wave of English criminal law, one golden thread is always to be seen, that it is the duty of the prosecution to prove the prisoner's guilt, subject to what I've already said as to the defense of insanity, and subject to also to any statutory exception. If at the end of and on the whole of the case, there is a reasonable doubt created by the evidence given by either the prosecution or the prisoner as to whether the prisoner killed the deceased with a malicious intention, the prosecution has not made out the case and the prisoner is entitled to an acquittal. No matter what the charge or where the trial, the principle that the prosecution must prove the guilt of the prisoner is part of the common law of England, and no attempt to whittle it down can be entertained, close quotation. Arising from the above, since this case, which was before the lower trial court, was one which was, can you get something to quench that cough, which is, I hope it's not this other virus which is flying around. Since the case which was before the lower court was one which was criminal, in which the criminal burden of proof of guilt of the accused is placed squarely on the prosecution, with that burden resting upon it in respect of every element or essential fact that makes up the offense with which the accused has been charged, then that burden never shifts to the accused. There's no obligation, therefore, whatsoever on the accused to prove any fact or issue that is in dispute before the court. And it is, of course, not, and I've emphasized not, for the accused to prove is or are innocent, but for the prosecution. On the other hand, the standard of proof in a criminal case is one in which the prosecution must prove an accused's guilt beyond reasonable doubt. That is the highest standard of proof that the prosecution must achieve before a court can convict an accused person with the words meaning exactly what they say, proof beyond reasonable doubt. This means that a court, at the end of considering evidence in the trial and the submissions made to it by the parties, must ask itself whether the prosecution has established the accused's guilt beyond reasonable doubt, for as Lord Denning put it in the case of Miller versus Minister of Pensions, also another English case of 1940, reported in 1947, volume 2, All England Law Report, at page 72. The prosecution evidence should be of such standard as to leave no other logical explanation to be derived from the fact that indeed it was the accused who committed the offense. This is also a position which was considered in Wilmington versus DPP, as I've cited above. Though the prosecution could negative a defense as not proving to absolute certainty, as was held in our very own case, in the case of Israel Epuku, son of Achiotu, versus R, found in 1934, I, page 166, especially at page 167, nonetheless. B, duty of the appellate court. The primary function to review and correct errors made in the primary or trial courts and may evaluate and scrutinize the evidence given in lower court and come to its own conclusion, as was pointed by Kato J, as it then was in Kalange versus Uganda, criminal appeal number 18 of 1994, reported in 1996, UGHCCRD, volume 2 of February 22, 1996, a position which was restated by the Supreme Court of Uganda in the celebrated case of Kifar Mutai Henry versus Uganda, Supreme Court's criminal appeal number 10 of 1997, which pointed out that though a first appellate court has a duty to rehear a case and to reconsider the materials before the trial judge and make up its own mind, it must not do so by disregarding the judgment appealed from, but carefully weighing and considering it. Uganda versus Ngasireki Paul and Kivumbi Awali, criminal appeal number 3 of 2017, arising from criminal appeal number 4, only interfering with the decision of the lower court where there has been gross miscarriage of justice occasioned by on any one party during the proceeding. So it collapses all the grounds into these two issues. So I will now go to discuss whether lower trial court had jurisdiction to hear the case against the appellant. During the hearing of this appeal, the appellant raised the issue of whether the lower court had jurisdiction to hear the case against her at all, since the place of posting of the alleged obscene post within the meaning of the provision section 21, paragraph subsection 1, paragraph 2A of the Computer Misuse Act 2 of 2011 was not proven by any evidence adduced in the court. For the avoidance of doubt, the full provision section 24.1.2A reads, cyber harassment. One, A, a person who commits cyber harassment is liable on conviction to a fine not exceeding 72 currency points or imprisonment not exceeding 3 years or both. Two, for purposes of this section, cyber harassment is the use of a computer for any of the following purposes. A, making any request, suggestion, or proposal which is obscene, lewd, lascivious, or indecent. B, threatening to inflict injury or physical harm to the person or property of any person. Or C, knowingly permits any electronic communication device to be used for any of the purposes mentioned in this section. In this appeal, I note the appellant was charged specifically under section 24.1.2A of the Computer Misuse Act, which relates to the making any request, suggestion, or proposal which is obscene, lewd, lascivious, or indecent. Some misuse act. And the general definitions. A computer is defined, and I quote, an electronic, magnetic, optical, electrochemical, or other data processing device, or a group of such interconnected or related devices performing logical, arithmetic, or storage functions, and it includes any data storage facility or communications facility directly related to or operating in conjunction with such a device or group of such interconnected or related devices. Close quotation. In the lower court, the appellant was convicted by the lower court on the offense under the section, which is section 24.1.2a, which led to misuse of a computer for purposes of obscene, lewd, lascivious, or indecent publication. The key words here are the use of a computer and making any request, suggestion, or proposal which is lewd, or no, which is obscene, lewd, lascivious, or indecent. From the act itself, I do not get clear definition of these words. Therefore, it would seem to me that the general dictionary meaning would suffice. I've looked at the web, and found the meaning of the offense, the definition of cyber harassment. This is according to a US website, HTTPS, whatever it is, definitions.uslegal.com, see cyber harassment. Cyber harassment is defined as, and I quote, the use of email, instant messaging, and derogatory websites to bully or otherwise harass an individual or group through personal attacks. Cyber harassment can be in the form of flames, comments made in chat rooms, sending of offensive or cruel email, or even harassing others by posting on blogs or social networking sites. Cyber harassment is often difficult to track, as the person responsible for the acts of cyber harassment remains anonymous while threatening others online. The reading of this section imports the incontestable requirement for a conviction to be returned by a court of law. The prosecution must prove that a computer was used by the person before the court, and that the person in court and that computer was in Uganda. Therefore, it is imperative that what is known technically as the digital footprint is proven. A device identity, IMEI, which is a unique 15-digit code that precisely identifies the device with the SIM card input, where its first 14 digits are definable by the Global System for Mobile Communications, GSM, a standard developed by the European Telecommunications Standards Institute to describe the protocols for second-generation digital cellular networks used by mobile devices such as mobile phones and tablets. And this was first deployed in Finland in December 1991, but is now operating in over 193 countries and territories, including Uganda, and is now established by what is known as an association called GSM Association Organization. And these are technical, the Modulus 10 or Mod 10 algorithm, named after its creator, an IBM scientist named Hans-Peter Lund, which is a simple checksum formula used to validate a variety of identification numbers such as IME numbers and national provider identifier numbers. The device's location, / IP address, and the traffic data emanating from such a device, which when put together, would constitute the digital footprint that would forensically link the commission of the offense under the impunged section of the act with the instant appellant. Additionally, such digital footprint would then enable a court to verify it where it has the jurisdiction to try the offense. It is the case of the appellant that the prosecution relied on the generic word computer as defined in the act to connect the appellant with the commitment of the offense under which and the act, without identifying the form of computer which according to the appellant was an error. Additionally, the appellant submits that according to Section 25 of the Computer Misuse Act, the actus reus in regards to offense charge refers to a specific location-based event as a vital ingredient of the offense with the absence of any of these ingredients, any evidence pointing to this effect, making any conviction which not take into account those vital ingredients being unsafe, untenable, and unlawful. The importance of location as creating jurisdiction has been held by the court to be vital for a charge to stand in any court. I refer to the cases of Desai versus Wasama, East African Law Reports at page 1967, at page 351, at page 352 to 354. The case of Hassan Basaja Balaba versus Bennett Kakande, I Court Criminal Report, volume 2 of 2013, at page 8 to 10, and Uganda versus Cassiano Wadri and others, I Court Criminal Report, volume 2 of 2018, at page 2012. In relation to the instant appeal, counsel for the appellants argues that the judgment and the subsequent conviction and the sentencing of the appellant by the lower court was carried out without the court having jurisdiction, rendering the whole process illegal, null, and void ab initio. In order for a court to exercise appropriate authority, that court must be clothed with appropriate jurisdiction, which jurisdiction is granted by statute. Jurisdiction has been defined to mean the authority conferred by law upon the court to decide or adjudicate any dispute between the parties or pass judgment or order. A court cannot adjudicate a matter in which he has no cause. This is as was articulated in the case of Koboko District Local Government versus Okudju-Swale High Court Miscellaneous Application No. 1 of 2016.